Okay, so we'll be going through a lot of the vibe coding related news from last week. First of all, we have a brand new update to SWE Bench Pro benchmark from Scale AI. And this is basically their own much hotter version of the SWE Bench Verified benchmark that you see a lot of the model providers like to use. And as you can see in the case of the Claude models, they're slowly getting to top of this particular benchmark, which means that we need to have hotter ones, like the one that Scale AI came up with. Anyways, you can see that they have a bunch of new models like Claude Sonnet 4.5, Claude Sonnet 4, Claude 4.5 Haiku, which does surprisingly well, both within the error margin, and then GPT-5 High, and also Kimi K2 seems to do surprisingly well in this benchmark as well. Meanwhile, it seems that Claude Opus 4.1 is kind of irrelevant now. Unfortunately, they don't have GLM 4.5, which is a pretty interesting model, or 4.6, but maybe they'll add it soon. Now, as I have talked about before, your performance for each of these models can vary depending on which agentic environment you're using, whether that's Cursor, OpenCode, Cloud Code, or Line Code, or basically any of the other agentic coding tools that are available. And this is pretty clear with Droid, for example, because when Droid came out last month, their brand new update, you can see that for the same models, it performs better than Claude Code, Codex CLI, on the same, well, terminal bench accuracy benchmark. And that's because they really nailed the agentic loop that the model is operating in. So you may actually see different performances for each of these models, depending on which agentic environment you're using it in. Anyway, something else interesting that I saw recently is this mixed model performance thing that is on Droid. And you can see that when they use Sonnet 4.5, they get this score on terminal bench. When they use GLM 4.5 Air, which is one of the open source Chinese models, they get 34.6%. And when they use Sonnet 4.5 for specification, but for executing and actually writing the code, they use GLM 4.5 Air, then they get very close to Sonnet 4.5. Like, you probably would expect this to be closer to middle, but it's closer to Sonnet 4.5. And I have heard that to be generally true. Many people are using Sonnet 4.5 to plan out what changes should be made in Claude Code, for example. And then they switch to a lighter weight model like Claude 4.5 Haiku instead to do the implementation of the code because it's faster and also like more cost effective. Anyways, we're going to talk about the Claude Code updates. And it is worth mentioning that I also released my Claude Code Masterclass. So if you go to masterclaudecode.com, you should see it. And there are a bunch of useful lessons, basically for every single feature that is available in Claude Code, as well as a bunch of bonus content and lessons for features and use cases that I haven't really talked about before on this channel. And I am still working my Codex CLI Masterclass, so do stay tuned for that. Anyways, the first big change is a brand new UI for the permissions prompt. So if you do /permissions, then you can see now has like a tab structure, and it also includes workspaces as well. So when you do /add dir to add a directory, then it also appears in here. And this seems like slightly nicer, more convenient. They also improved the /resume command. So when you do /resume, then you can see you can press B to toggle the branch. So to only see sessions that were made on your current branch to avoid like accidentally opening a session that happened on a different branch. And you can also do /to start searching. So I can search like Japanese and then I can see when I implemented Japanese language support to my application. So this makes the resuming session significantly easier. Now, something else that I did mention in my previous video is this brand new interactive question tool. And I have found it to be useful in some cases, but in other cases it can be annoying. So if you do want to disable it, then you can put in this command into your settings. So if you do deny in your settings.json, ask user question, then it won't ask any questions anymore. Something else pretty interesting that I came across is this Claude Code Viewer. And this basically helps you see what's happening under the hood, because I think it's intercepting the requests that are happening to the Anthropic API servers, and then like parsing the requests and putting them in a nice UI. You can see what kind of tool calls and commands and messages were passed from the main agent to the subagent. And also you can see what the subagent exactly did. I think this is probably most useful for those people who use subagents quite a lot, because you can see how information is being passed from the main agent to the subagent and back to the main agent. And you can probably change your prompt around to make sure better information or the correct information is being passed, so the main agent and subagents can make better decisions overall. Now we also have some Codex CLI updates. They haven't really updated it much over the last month or so, so I'm not exactly sure what they're doing, but I imagine they're cooking something big. Anyways, we now have a /feedback command, and if you do that, then you can say whether that's a bug, bad result, good result, or something else entirely. They also made a bunch of improvements to MCP servers, so you can do things such as specifying which tools are enabled, disabled. They also added a brand new thing, which is add dir, to allow you to add an additional working directory. And this is pretty similar to what already exists in Claude Code with add dir. But in the case of Codex CLI, it seems you have to trigger it by doing this instead when you're launching Codex CLI for the first time. And after adding it, it should be able to look through both directories, even though it just says directory here. It will have multiple working directories. They also say they made the slash compact command much more stable, and they added auto compaction too. And auto compaction happens around 90% of the context window being full, as you can see in this pull request. And apparently last week, OpenAI engineer ran Codex on an extremely hard task for over 60 hours. This took roughly a dozen auto compactions. They're much more stable now. But I guess the main thing here is whether it would be successful after 60 hours. Because I guess anyone can get Codex CLI or another agent to run for like 100 plus hours, but whether the result is actually good is a different story. And as for some Cursor related news, it seems that Cursor 2.0 is going to be coming out soon. Some people have been teasing some features from it online. I don't seem to see the feature myself, so maybe I have to switch to early access or something. But you can see there are a few changes. You can see that there's a microphone icon, so you can speak directly into Cursor. There's also an option where you can have a run in the background on the cloud with Cursor background agents, run in parallel with different work trees, or just run locally normally on your device. And it also seems you will be able to run multiple models at the same time. And I think it will likely be running on different work trees, and then maybe you combine the solution together somehow, or pick the best solution. I'm not exactly sure how this will work yet. And another pretty interesting tool that I've been trying recently is Compile, spelled with a Y. And what made me interested in this was this like image over here, where it basically helps you come up with like a pretty useful plan. So for my application Tensor AI, I was adding like a feature that allows users to archive articles that they already read. So you'd be able to swipe to the left or right or something, and then archive an article. So I first told it to come up with a plan for me on how to implement this feature. And then it generated some UI mockups as well after asking me some clarifying questions. And then I was like, yes, I want it to be green with an icon or something, like in this diagram. And then in the next diagram, it then showed me like, does this unarchiving page look good? And I'm like, no, I don't want the button over here. So what I find really useful here is that you can actually see visually what kind of changes would end up being made. And that gives you a much more robust plan overall. And then you can see this is a plan that I came up with at the end. So I should be able to give this plan to an agent like Haiku 4.5 or something, because it's like pretty long, robust, everything is in there. Or maybe give it to an even cheaper Chinese model, for example, and then have it execute on the plan. You can also get it to execute on the plan within Compile, but I haven't really tried that feature yet. But ultimately, I think that people are slowly becoming worse and lazier at prompting over time, so there will be a new set of tools like Compile that basically help people prompt better or come up with better plans through a bunch of clarifying questions. I think the standout here for me has been the like UI related components. And also the questions that it has been asking me seem to be more natural than the questions that I've been getting from Claude Code in the plan interactive questions mode. So I think there's a lot of room in this like planning sort of domain for development, and I'm pretty excited to see where this product or maybe other products go. Anyways, that's basically it for the video. If you do want to check out my brand new Master Claude Code class, there will be a coupon code down below with a link. And if you do want to check out the programs that I personally make in Vibe Code, like HyperWhisper, there will be links and coupon codes for those down below. Because I don't accept any sponsors on the channel and pay for the subscriptions myself, it's all funded by the softwares and classes that I sell. And if you do want to see anything new in this brand new This Week in Vibe Coding series that I'm doing, then do leave a comment down below and I will make the future videos in the series much better. And if you do enjoy this kind of stuff and want to see more of it, then do subscribe to the channel, because it lets the algorithm know that this is a good video and everything like that.